Hello, everyone, and welcome to WeSonic Global Dandenong College webinar. This is a platform for sharing and learning more about regional anesthesia, pain management, and intensive care. Today, it's really our great honor to invite Dr. Durs to be here as our speaker. He is one of the top experts in the field of regional anesthesia. Please let me introduce Dr. Durzu briefly. Dr. Durzu started his training in the field of anesthesiology and intensive care in Romania in 2006. Since then, a main focus of his work has been regional anesthesia and acute and chronic pain treatment. In 2015, he was the founder and became the chairman of regional Romanian Association of Regional Anesthesia and Pain Therapy, the national representative of ESRA. After serving 4 years as council member for ESRA representing Romania in 2019, Dr. Durzu was elected ESRA board member in 2017. He obtained certification for his skills in chronic pain therapy by graduating Pain School International in Budapest, a fellowship organized by World Institute of Pain. Starting 2020, Dr. Durzu continues his work as the head of anesthesia and intensive care unit 2 department in Emergency County Hospital Cluj-Napoca. Now, Dr. Durzu will share the topic of lumbar plexus blocks. Let's welcome Dr. Durzu with his speech. Welcome.
Thank you, Olga, so much for the nice introduction. Thank you, WeSonic, for organizing this panel. And it's a huge honor to be invited to have this lecture. I must admit, I'm not a very big fan of this kind of interaction. If you ever been to one of my lectures, you know that I like very much to work with the audience, to see the reactions, to make as much as interactive as possible. Unfortunately, this kind of lecture will not allow me to have my usual lectures. So I will just speak to my laptop, hoping that someone will also hear what I am saying. So the topic for today is the nerve blocks of the lumbar plexus. And just a slide to show you who I am, where I am from. My home city is Cluj-Napoca. It's in the middle of the country. It's the one with the red here. It's not the capital of the Romania. The capital of Romania is here, the Bucharest. It's a very nice city. This is an image taken from the center of the city. My hospital is right here in the right part of this image. And of course, it's well known for a lot of things. It's a good touristic place. You can come and visit a lot of things. You can see we had, before this pandemic, we had a big health festival, Untold. If you are a fan of the modern music, you can find that online and to have information about it. And of course, it's the birthplace of the Romanian Association of Regional Anesthesia and Pain Therapy, the Romanian representative of ESRA, which I am currently running. So the synopsis for the today lecture, we will talk about the blocks of the lumbar plexus. We will talk about the posterior approach, the psoas compartment block, and we will talk about the anterior approach, the also called 3-in-1 or fascia iliaca block. Basically, they are more or less same block. We will talk about the peripheral approaches of the lumbar plexus nerves, the iliohypogastric, ilioinguinal, genitofemoral, the femoral nerve, the saphenous nerve, the sensitive branch of the femoral nerve, the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, of course, and about the obturator nerve. And we will talk a little bit about the terminal branches of the lumbar plexus, the so-called pericapsular nerve group block. It's the new kid on the block in ultrasound-guided nerve blocks, and the geniculate nerves. Just a very, very short review of the anatomy of the lumbar plexus. You all know it's starting from the lumbar vertebras. That's why it's called the lumbar plexus. And it's the spinal nerve, after dividing, it has this trajectory coming around the abdomenum and following the abdominal wall, branching in the terminal branches. Of course, there are a lot of things to discuss about this, but we will approach them when we will talk also about the techniques. When are these blocks useful? They are useful when we are doing anesthesia and postoperative pain control for the inguinal hernia repair. They are very useful for hip surgery, for femur surgery, both proximal and distal. They are useful for knee surgery, but not used alone, of course, for tibial surgery, for the transurethral resection of bladder tumor, we will talk about it, and there are some acute and chronic painful conditions where it might be useful to perform this kind of blocks. So without other comments, let's talk about the posterior approach. It has many names. It was called psoas compartment block. It was called lumbar paravertebral block or lumbar plexus block. What we are trying to do is to deposit local anesthetic solution that will have this spread that you see here on the right image. And the spreading of the local anesthetic will encounter the spinal nerve, creating anesthesia or analgesia, depending on what concentration you use to perform the block. It's basically a fascial plane block, and this fascial layer is the one covering the psoas muscles, and of course, the spinal nerves are inside this space. So depending on the concentration, you will have anesthesia or analgesia of the ilioinguinal, genitofemoral, left cutaneous, lateral cutaneous femoral nerve, the femoral nerve, and of course the obturator nerve. It's you need to understand that it's a deep target. Sometimes you have up to 8 centimeters until you are reaching your target. So this means that very small errors in positioning the needle at the skin will create you big deviations at the tip of the needle. So the chances to be wrong are increased if you don't understand this mechanics. And it is considered a high-risk block due to the possibility of neuraxial spread of the local anesthetic you are injecting, and also the presence of the blood vessel at this level, which makes it not a block to start your training with. So you need to be experienced before approaching these kind of blocks, even though you will see we are trying to perform this block by using bony structure, which technically should be easier. There is also, of course, a landmark technique being described. These pictures are taken for the NYSORA website. It's very easy actually to perform it. You just take a needle, find the midline, go 4 centimeter lateral to the midline, and insert perpendicularly to the skin your needle. And once you feel a pop, you know that you passed the fascial layer of the psoas muscle. Of course, if you are encountering bony structure, then probably you hit the transversus process. You just need to a little bit reorientate your needle, and here you are. And just injecting after carefully aspiration. Of course, you can use also a nerve stimulator to confirm your position, but why should we do that? As long as we have ultrasound machine, very, very good ultrasound machine that we can use now. So this one in the left side is a transversal approach, and your transducer is in the lateral part of the body, and it's looking inside the body. So this is posterior, this is anterior, and what you can see here, you can see the vertebral body, you can see the transverse process, and you can see the spinal nerve entering his opening here. But of course, you need to have a very high person with a very low body mass index. This one here does not have more than 50 kilos. So it's very, very rare actually to see this image, but this is what you need to understand. And this here, it's of course the psoas muscle. This is a very fine, very, very good image that you can use to do a lot of things around the vertebras. For instance, if you are if you want to do the quadratus lumborum block, you will use the same approach, only that your target will not be under the transversus process, will be depending on what kind of quadratus lumborum block you want to do, the tip or the anterior part of the posterior part of the of that muscle. But this is the nice image that you need to remember in the longitudinal approach. Of course, it's not so easy because actually you will enter the tip around here, where is my pointer now, and you will need to go a lot with your needle in the real life without actually seeing the needle, which will create some panic at the beginning. But once you get experience with this kind of procedures, you will see that actually you can use your ultrasound machine to make the procedure safer, even though when you are not seeing so well. In the right part of the screen, you have the longitudinal approach. So starting from the midline, I didn't add that images, but starting from the midline is very easy to understand. Just place your transducer like this, move it to the right side or to the left side of the body, depending where you want to perform your block. And when you are seeing these images here, which see they are bony structures, these are the transversus process. Take your needle, put it targeting between the transversus process, and once the needle tip passed, slipped in between two transversus process, then you can inject your local anesthetic and you can create a psoas muscle block. Of course, you can use it in plane, you can use it out of plane, depending on what is your favorite approach. There are no, there is no better way than other, as long as you're understanding the anatomy and you're understanding where is your needle tip, careful expiration, inject, see the spread of local anesthetic in this plane here, and you can do a psoas compartment block safe and with high chances of success. Of course, that's the picture for the textbook, and this is the real life. And what you are seeing here, you've seen before, but this is in the real life. This time, here is the posterior part, here is the anterior part, here is lateral. Here you can see the shadow of the vertebral body. You can see the shadow of the transversus process here. And you can imagine, because you don't actually see, but if you are watching carefully the movement, you see a needle, and now you saw a little bit of air being injected to confirm the position. So this sometimes when it's very, very difficult to perform the block, you are not only relying yourself on what you are seeing, but also in what you know. So basically, you can combine the landmark approach and you can use your ultrasound machine to visualize the place of injection. This is a very, very a man with a high body mass index. So this most of the time, this is as good as it gets. You can not have better quality of image. But if you can identify your needle advancing, watch the tip here, you have, it's a little trick that I make sometimes when it's very, very easy to inject in a deliberate way a small amount of air, because it will increase the visibility of the tip of the needle. So you saw the tip of the needle. I will run that again for you. Okay, so this is the body of the vertebra. This was here was the transversus process. I'm going between two transversus processes. I start my needling. I will advance with my needle carefully. So you see, you cannot actually see the needle. Also, the needle was not the best one that I had. The needle tip is somewhere here. You can say by the movement of the structures. Now it's here. And now it's here, and you saw the air entering the psoas compartment space. And now I can inject local anesthetic, and it will be a success, even though I didn't saw much during the procedure. But it's a safe procedure if you understand what you are doing. Okay, so this is how to perform the posterior approach of the psoas compartment. And now we will talk about the anterior approach. And I just want to quote this paper, which I found very, very inspiring, because this will show you that increasing the volume of the local anesthetic you are injecting, you will create a better block. And while reading this paper, I asked myself why to stop here to 50 milliliters. So a lot of the times you will see me injecting up to 60 milliliter in one side when I am performing the fascia iliaca block. It was also called 3-in-1 and fascia iliaca. It's basically the anterior approach of the psoas compartment. So what you will expect when you will do this, it will not go as high as the posterior approach. So you will have only the lateral cutaneous femoral nerve. You will have the femoral nerve and the obturator nerve encountering your local anesthetic solution. It's a very superficial target, and you can do it also without ultrasound machine. And I think it's a very good place to perform this kind of block in the emergency departments. I think it's very useful for the patients with fracture of the femur, of the femoral neck. You all know they are very painful conditions, and the people having these pathologies are very, very frail. So they need a lot of painkillers. But if we will start training our emergency doctors to perform this kind of procedure in the emergency department, I think we have a chance to improve the morbidity and the mortality related with this pathology. It's a very low risk block, so can be used also in the pre-hospital setup. And it has a high success rate as long as you are not afraid and you are giving the proper amounts of local anesthetic. So you need to use huge volume, a lot more than you will expect if you are a novice in local anesthesia, in regional anesthesia. Of course, there is a landmark technique. It's very, very easy to perform just under the inguinal canal. In this area printed with yellow here, you feel two pops while advancing with the needle, gently aspire, see that you don't have blood in your needle, and just inject the total amount of local anesthetic. Of course, you'll never inject, if you are using 60 milliliters, you'll never inject in one push all the volume of the local anesthetic. Usually when I perform fascial plane block, I inject aliquots of 5 milliliters. So inject 5 milliliters, again aspire. Inject 5 milliliters, again aspire, to be sure that you did not replace your needle during the procedure, and to be sure you are not injecting in a vessel to create side effects. Also, it is very important, because if you are injecting slowly, you will give time for the local anesthetic solution to spread in the fascial plane, and it will improve your effectiveness of your block. We also have ultrasound techniques, not just one, but more. This is the, so with the yellow line is the place where you are placing your transducer. This is the simplest way you can have a fascia iliaca block, starting from the femoral artery and scanning to the lateral. So here was the femoral artery, scanning to the lateral. You will see the body of the iliac muscle. And here you can inject anywhere your local anesthetic solution to perform a fascia iliaca block. Be very careful, because if you are scanning too distal, here is another muscle that I sometimes seen by novices to be wrongly assumed that is the iliacus muscle. Actually, is the sartorius muscle. You know, it's coming from the lateral to the medial part. And if you are scanning too distally, you might be tempted to say that this is the iliacus muscle. It's not. Okay, so be careful to see this image when you are doing your injection and you are injecting here. The second approach of the fascia iliaca block is with the transducer in this position here, and you are just following the body of the iliacum bone as high as possible, and you want to interpret this line as being the fascia iliaca. Just go with the needle under it and perform the block. Of course, if you are going high enough, and you will have a better local anesthetic solution. But if you are afraid in doing so, at the beginning you can start only under the inguinal inguinal ligament, but you can also go higher than this. And we have, of course, the supra-inguinal approach in transversal position, which I think is the best approach you can use. And not it's not just me, all the colleagues around the world are performing this kind of approaches now. Basically, from the axis here, you just scan a little bit distally. It's the same, it's almost the same position where you replace the transducer to find the ilioinguinal and the iliohypogastric nerve. Only for those, the transducer will be placed oblique. For this, you are placing perfect transversally. And while scanning, follow the body of the iliac muscle, as you see it here. Put your needle under the fascia, inject your local anesthetic, give large volumes, and you will see the spread and you will have a good quality block. One thing it's important to understand when performing fascial plane blocks, it's the proper spreading of the local anesthetic solution. And here you see the needle entering this space here. And if you are watching carefully, you see that the local anesthetic is spreading actually in two spaces, here and here. It is a good approach. You will have good effectiveness. But if you want to perform the best block you can have, you need to have your needle between the layers of fascia iliaca. And when you are injecting, you want to see that the local anesthetic solution is dislodging the tissues. And in this way, it will be spreading a lot in the cephala direction, and it will improve the effectiveness of your block. I will play the movie one more time. Because I found it very, very important to understand this spreading pattern. So this was good, but not perfect. And this is perfect. See the needle tip, see the opening of the needle, see how the local anesthetic spread up to here. And you can use your needle to reposition, to go more cephalad, and to inject small aliquots to displace the tissues. Of course, you're not have all the time this kind of visualization, but try it as many times as possible to see it in this way. Okay, enough about that. We will go further to talk about the distal nerves of the lumbar plexus. We will talk about the ilioinguinal, iliohypogastric, and the genitofemoral nerve. They are useful for inguinal hernia repair, both for anesthesia and analgesia. And unfortunately, a lot of chronic pain conditions, a lot of patients are coming to pain clinic after surgeries, and not only after surgery, but neuropathies on these nerves are not so rare as we would like to think. First, the ilioinguinal and the iliohypogastric. I was telling you before, the transducer is placed here at the axis, anterior superior iliac spine, looking at the obliquus, so on this line here. You need to see the bone here to be sure you will find the nerve, and just look between the muscle layers. Most of the times, you will find both ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric nerve in the same place. You can see them both here, okay? Between the transversus abdominis and obliquus internus. Depending where you are scanning, you need to understand that the three muscle layers of the abdominum, you will only see two, because if you are scanning in the right position, the oblique externus does not have a muscle body, it has a fascial layer. That's why you are seeing two muscles here. But you need to understand that there is a high variability of these nerves. So sometimes you can have one here, one here. Sometimes you can have one here, one here. Sometimes you can have vessels accompanying the two nerves. So that's why it's important to scan. If you are holding your transducer like this, just slide your transducer along the nerve trajectory. So if the nerves are coming like here, your transducer will be scanning, you will be replaced like here. See that the nerve structure is maintained and there is your nerve, there is your place of injection. Just seeing the muscle layers and injecting as in a transversus abdominis plane block, it will not guarantee the success of your block. So you need to actually see the nerves to perform this kind of block. For the genitofemoral nerve, it's not so common to perform this kind of block. Why? He is useful, and we all know that it has implication in the inguinal canal, and it's useful for hernia repair. But actually, the genitofemoral nerve comes in the inguinal canal, so this is the place where actually it's your hernia. So you will not see it when you are doing this for hernia repair. The transducer is placed like this. Here is the femoral artery seen in longitudinal plane. Just scan a little bit cephalad and watch for an oval shape thing, and that's your injection place. Okay, so the spermatic cord or the ligamentum in the females, and the genitofemoral nerve is accompanying them. It's going together. So just put your local anesthetic solution around them. Is more useful for chronic pain procedure than for acute pain. And usually, in my experience at least, is the genitofemoral nerve is performed by the surgeon during the procedure. I start with the ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric blocks, and the surgeon is performing the genitofemoral during his intervention. The femoral nerve block is one of the easiest blocks to perform in ultrasound guided regional anesthesia. Why? Because we are being taught that you are just watching the femoral artery, and in lateral you can find the femoral nerve. Actually, it's not quite so. And this here, the so-called femoral triangle, is not the femoral nerve. And the upper part of this triangle is formed by the fascial layer of the fascia iliaca and the fascia lata. And the femoral nerve is the one being placed at the bottom of the triangle. So only here. But anyway, it is a good way to understand how to perform the block, how to find it. But if you want to be very, very strict in what you are saying you are doing, it's actually what you are doing. If you want to perform a femoral nerve block, you need to use a good quality ultrasound machine and to understand that the femoral nerve is the one being placed right here. But again, if you have a fat, a high body mass index patient and you are looking to the femoral artery, you just need to understand if which is lateral. So if this is lateral, then I will inject here. If this is lateral, I will inject here. You just need to understand this, and you will perform a femoral nerve block even though you didn't see the femoral nerve. That's why it is useful, because it is followed with the femoral artery. What you can expect when you are performing this kind of block: anesthesia or analgesia for the anterior aspect of the thigh, and also for the medial aspect of the leg below the knee. So if you want to perform a sciatic nerve block for the tibial surgery, you need to remember that you will also have a saphenous component there, and the saphenous nerve also should be blocked. Otherwise, your patient will be in pain. Just want to show you the injection. So usually we are performing this kind of injection, and we are telling everybody that we perform a femoral nerve block, but actually the femoral nerve is the one here. If you don't understand this, it's not a problem if you are injecting here because the local anesthetic will go here and it will block the femoral nerve. But if you will target this area here, then the chances are that you are going to hit the femoral nerve and you will create neuropathies, because the older school in regional anesthesia, and I did also this until a few years ago, are teaching us that you cannot create neuropathies on the femoral nerve because it's very, very spreaded in this area. Actually, it's not quite so. Unfortunately, I had the opportunity to see a few femoral neuropathies in the patient that previous they had femoral nerve block for this kind of surgery. So this complication comes from the fact that people don't understand that actually the femoral nerve is placed here. What I like to do is to take the needle, put it between the femoral nerve and the femoral artery, inject here, and if I want to complete the block, I may go around it. But most of the times, you will have the spreading around the nerve, just like you are seeing here. So this is the pretty much everything you need to know to perform a safe femoral nerve procedure. About the saphenous nerve, the sensitive ending of the femoral nerve, it's a motor sparing alternative to the femoral nerve block. You need to understand that if you are doing it too proximal and you use high volume to perform the block, motor block, it's still possible. So if it is important for you to, because most of the people who will want to do a saphenous nerve block, we will do it to avoid the motor block. It is important to understand that you need to follow the saphenous nerve as distal as possible and to avoid using large volume of local anesthetic. It might be a better solution if you want to increase the length of your block to put a catheter and to use small volumes per hour to prolong the block. And also here, it is important to understand that different spread of injection will create different kind of blocks. And what I noticed to most of the almost failing block in terms of long time until the effect and very, very fast washout of the effect is that the people, because they are being afraid they might be too close to the nerve and to the artery, they are injecting in a wrong space. And when they are injecting, actually the local anesthetic goes between the muscles. So we are performing here this block at a subsartorial level. This is the sartorial, so we are at the mid-thigh, okay? But see that while injecting, the local anesthetic was spreaded here, and we don't want to do that because this will be translated in low effectiveness. And what you actually want to do is to inject under this fascial layer here that is keeping together the artery and the nerves. This is continued also in the next slide. So see, here was the place where we injected first time, and here we are injecting now. And look that while injecting in the right space, the local anesthetic is going around the artery and the saphenous nerve is here surrounded with local anesthetic. This will create a fast onset of the block, and this will also create a long time for your block. Okay. See the saphenous nerve, how it maintained here. So of course you will ask, but this may increase the risk to do neural lesions. It's true, but if you have a good coordination of your hand, and you are never targeting the nerve. So you saw me first time I was here with my needle, and now I'm targeting under the nerve with my needle, but never go in this direction with your needle. So if you are careful with this, then the chances that you will create nerve damages are low. Of course, don't start it alone. Try to be with someone that it is experienced with this kind of procedure before doing alone, okay? So this is about the saphenous nerve. We will go further to discuss about lateral cutaneous femoral nerve. It's also used for anesthesia, but also for analgesia, and it is very important for chronic pain or condition called neuralgia paresthetica, which is a neuropathy of this nerve. If you don't have experience and you are asking where is that useful for anesthesia, if you're working in plastic surgery, when they are doing skin graft, the lateral aspect of the thigh, it's one frequent place for donor site. So if you are doing this block and you have a good communication with a surgeon to make him understand where is the place where they need to harvest the skin, it is very, very useful to be used for this kind of. Otherwise, you need to do a lot of more potent blocks, like a spinal block, or to do even general anesthesia. But if you are thinking at this, you can use it. For example, when you are doing skin graft on your hand, you can do a brachial plexus block together with the lateral cutaneous femoral nerve, and it's a very, very elegant solution to do anesthesia to this kind of patient. Of course, there is also a landmark technique. Most of us, we are know it from the time we don't have an ultrasound machine. If you are putting a needle 2 centimeters medial and 2 centimeters distal to the anterior superior iliac spine, to the axis, you will find the right place. But if you are using an ultrasound machine and you don't have a good one, for example, then you need to see the sartorius muscle to understand where is the lateral part of the sartorius muscle. And this is the place where you need to look for the nerve. Scan distally and caudally and cephalad and caudal, and see the same appearance that is maintained. And this is the nerve, and just put your local anesthetic there. If you want to perform anesthesia, the landmark technique, it's enough, and you will compensate by using large amounts of local anesthetic. But if you are interested to perform this block for the chronic pain conditions, then you need to actually see the nerve. Otherwise, you are not sure what you've done. You are not sure if your diagnosis was correct. The obturator nerves are responsible for the abduction of the thigh during the transurethral resection of blood tumor. And I think it is very, very important to understand this, because a lot of these patients are with a lot of chronic disease, and we want to avoid general surgery and to avoid give myorelaxants to this kind of patients. So performing a spinal anesthesia and obturator nerve block to this kind of patient may be very, very useful. Of course, if you are interested to do analgesia for major knee surgery by using the trunks, the nerve blocks, and not the modern approaches that are described now, you will also need to block the obturator nerves as they are involved in the innervation of the knee. And postoperative analgesia after hamstring tendon harvest for the anterior cruciate ligament. So if you are working with orthopedics performing this kind of procedure, remember that obturator nerve blocks is very, very useful for the reconstruction of the anterior cruciate ligament. And of course, there are also a lot of chronic pain conditions with the involvement of these nerves that you want to block to make diagnosis or to treat these conditions. It's not an easy nerve block to perform. So you are scanning in the at the base of the thigh. Here it's medial, here is lateral. Here you see the pectineus nerve. And basically you are going now from the artery, you are going in the medial part, okay? And look between the adductor muscles. You see the body of the adductor muscles here. Here is one, here is the other, and here is another. This is the pectineal muscle. And this thickness you are seeing here between them is the obturator nerve. Just put your needle here and here, and you are injecting local anesthetic solution, and it's done. Of course, this image, it's easy to understand when your patient is not obese. If your patient is obese, then it's not quite so simple as it is in this picture. And a few things about the peripheral approaches. The so-called PANC block, I think you all know it because it's very, very popular these days. Pericapsular nerve group, it's useful for hip pain, also for acute and chronic conditions. I must admit that I'm not doing it for acute pain. I'm only doing this kind of block for chronic pain patients, the one who are not fitted for hip replacement, but actually there are less and less people because surgeons improve their technique and we are not so restrictive now with whom we offer hip replacement now. Sometimes I use it to alleviate pain until the patients are waiting on the list for hip replacement. And I think it is also interesting to study this block to perform radiofrequency ablation to perform long-term analgesia. So basically, I will not go into the anatomy. I'm sure you know it already. You know that in iliopectineal, in this part of the bony structure, you have the sensitive branches going to the anterior hip capsule, innervating them, which is basically the major source of pain in hip pathologies. So if you are holding your transducer like this and just scan in the direction of the arrow and back, you can see this is the femoral neck, and this is the place where you want to perform your injection. So you want to go as farther as possible just before your image becomes round. Okay, go back and here you are performing your injection. It's useful if you have also neck fractures. You can provide analgesia for the neck fractures. Just remember, if you are choosing to do this procedure, that you are looking now deeper that you looked for the fascia iliaca block. Fascia iliaca is here in our image. So this is the iliac muscle, and we perform here. And if you are not very, very mindful to this, you might not overlook the fact that here is the femoral artery and you don't want to pierce it while trying to do the procedure if you are doing the middle approach. A few things about the geniculate nervous blocks. You know there are three places of injection for this. It's very useful for knee pain. It's also a place to look for radiofrequency ablation to provide long-term analgesia, but you will never do it without performing a test block before. It is also very interesting there is a lot of interest to do this before the knee replacement. It seems that if we are doing radiofrequency ablation in these sites here before replacing the knee, we might provide better quality analgesia for our patients. Of course, there is a place for a lot of studies to perform in this area. And what you need to understand that to find the best place to inject your local anesthetic solution or to put your radiofrequency cannula, you hold your transducer like this, look for the area where the bony is curved, and you also need to check for the artery. So you have small arteriolas here, use the Doppler and inject your local anesthetic close to the arteriola and you are there. So this is in the upper part. And this is distally on the tibia, where you can see also the arteriola pulsating. So if you don't have a good ultrasound machine, you cannot actually see the nerve, but most of the time you will find the arteriola. Inject your local anesthetic very, very close and you can perform the block. And of course, I cannot end without inviting you to attend the National Congress of the Romanian Association of Regional Anesthesia and Pain Therapy, which is now scheduled for September. Basically, it's one day before the ESRA, we will have one day for the Romanian participants with basic procedure. And now I am thanking you for your attention. I think I finished a little bit earlier than we first scheduled, and I'm ready to answer your questions if you have any. Again, I feel like I was talking with myself. I only see Olga here. She has the video started to her laptop, so I can see her, but I cannot see anybody else. So I wonder, was I alone during this session? No, we have participants. Please ask questions. Okay, I found the questions. Contraindications and coagulation profile, ask someone. I guess it was because it was at 6.9. I think it was about the lumbar plexus block. Basically, the same things you will have considered when you will do a spinal and epidural, you will also have it here. So you will. So from the point of view of the coagulation profile, because it's a deep block, you will look at the lumbar plexus block. The same as we are looking at the neuroaxial anesthesia, at least until we have further evidences. Of course, there are the rules and there are selected cases, and sometimes we are forcing some indication to some people who otherwise they could not be operated. And of course, there are people, they will be telling you that they perform this kind of block to patients receiving new anti-aggregants, for example, but I cannot recommend you to do so. So in highly selected cases where it's no other way how you can solve this procedure, maybe I will consider it, but otherwise look at it just like the neuroaxial anesthesia. About the local anesthetic toxicity, of course, you will expect to have an increased local anesthetic toxicity if you inject it in the body of the muscle. You need to understand that this is a fascial plane block, and the problem with the fascial plane block and the local anesthetic systemic toxicity is when people, by accident, instead of injecting in the fascial plane, they are injecting in the nearby muscle. And injecting a local anesthetic in the nearby muscle, you will have a take up of the local anesthetic solution into the circulation. But if you are injected in the right spot, then you will not expect an increased local anesthetic toxicity. Actually, for this kind of blocks, I am using up to 3 mg/kg ropivacaine. Of course, I am very lucky because in my country we can use ropivacaine. I know there are countries where you can only use bupivacaine to perform blocks. For bupivacaine, the doses are lower. I never use more than 2 mg/kg, even though I know there are countries and there are centers with higher experience where they are crossing this line. I'm not doing it. But I'm using ropivacaine up to 3 mg/kg. That's why I am recommending to the fascia iliaca block to use 60 milliliters of local anesthetic solution. But again, the concentration is lower. It's 0.25. Sometimes for selected cases, when I want to do anesthesia using fascial plane block and not analgesia, sometimes I cheat and I use 0.33. I cannot tell you what it would be happen if I would be using 0.25, but this is what I am doing. So, but never go higher than 3 mg/kg. So I am adjusting the volume then. Sometimes it's saying, Carmen, it's saying that there are indeed many benefits for the lumbar plexus block, but it's not easy for a beginner to learn it quickly. I agree with you. So quick tips, I would say, go to cadaver workshops. So I think the best way to understand the mechanics of needling passing, of ultrasound coordination, is to go to the cadaver workshops. I think is the best way to learn to perform procedures. Okay, so this is what helped me a lot, going to cadaver workshops. No, the muscle, Jack asked us if the drug is injecting on the nerve or in the muscle fascia surrounding the nerve. Of course, it's in the fascial layer where you are injecting, and you are hoping that the local anesthetic solution will go close in the proximity of the nerve. What I showed you with the spinal nerve coming out under the transversus process, it's something very, very rare. And I was just showing you this to understand that even though you don't have this quality of image and you have the quality of image that I have on the movie, you can still do that procedure. So you don't need to target every time when you are performing a lumbar plexus block to actually see the nerves. It's very, very rare possible. You need to have very, very good ultrasound machine. Maybe with the one produced by our host is possible, because I was very, very surprised in using them, the quality of image. So maybe, but again, the patient, it's also important that most of our patients, they are not so fitted to have such a clear image at that depth. If the inguinal hernia surgery is blocked with a TAP block, will the effect be better than the lumbar plexus block? I don't use TAP block for inguinal hernia repair, and I don't use lumbar plexus block for inguinal hernia repair. I consider that the benefits are a lot lower than the risk. What I use for inguinal hernia repair, it is ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric nerve block. So I block them specifically at the axis. So this is what I do. I have no experience with TAP with lumbar plexus block, so I don't do it. But I can tell you, I do anesthesia using inguinal, ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric nerve block. So it's not only for analgesia, but also for anesthesia. Okay, compare with lumbar plexus block, is the sciatic nerve block better for superior surgery on the leg below the knee? No, you cannot compare those two. So the question is, so Zafer asking us if the lumbar plexus block, the sciatic nerve block is better for superficial surgery on the leg below the knee. You need to do them both. So most of your surgery will be enough with the sciatic nerve block. But if the medial aspect of tibia is involved, you also need to do the saphenous nerve block. Okay, so this is what is respecting the anatomy. So this obvious there is a difference because they are covering different parts of the leg. How long can lumbar plexus anesthesia last during the operation? So, in my experience, the initial injection, if you are using, so I use 20 to 30 milliliter of local anesthetic solution in one injection, it can last up to 4 hours, up to 4 hours. Sometimes it's less. So depending on the how good you perform the procedure, how accurate were you when you placed the needle inside the fascial layer and not in the muscle, I think this is the most important condition. So if you want to prolong your lumbar plexus anesthesia, then I recommend you to put a catheter there. It's a great place to put catheters, and I had patients maintaining 3 to 5 days catheter in this position. Catalin is asking us what substances can be used for chronic pain when performing the pain block, which is better according to your experience for better long-term effect. You cannot expect to have long-term effect. It's a wide discussion here. It might sound crazy, but I perform one single shot pain block to patients and they have long-term release of the pain. Why? Because I am using ropivacaine for chronic pain. I'm using ropivacaine and lidocaine in the injection. Why lidocaine? Because you want to have a very fast onset of the analgesia. Ropivacaine because you want to have a longer effect. And I use steroids when I perform chronic pain block. But what is happening is that for those kind of patients where the pain is chronic by the nature of the pain, which means they have chronic pain symptoms of allodynia, and you have the symptoms for chronic sensitization and centralization of the pain. What I noticed that if for those patients you are allowing them a short amount of time without pain, it's not that the pain is going away, but it's easily bearable for the patient, and it goes away to standard pain treatment after performing just one procedure. So if the symptoms of the patients are severe and it's involving centralization of the pain, you may expect for long-term effect. Otherwise, not so much. You cannot expect to have long-term effect. You can use to have a diagnosis. So you will know that performing a pain block to my patient will make the pain go away. And you are doing something more definitive, like the radiofrequency ablation of that region. You create a lesion, hoping that you will burn the sensitive nerves there. If I didn't ask it properly the questions, please ask again or complete your patients, because I will get to the questions, okay? So the treatment of the lumbar plexus block in chronic diseases can delay the patient's pain. Can it play a role in improving the conditions? Of course. The thing about chronic back pain is that it also has muscle implications. So if for your chronic pain patient, the psoas muscle contraction play a major role, you can expect by performing a lumbar plexus block to have also long-term improving on the painful condition, but because the muscles was involved and you are offering a period of relaxation with this. Of course, a good chiropractor or masseur will have the same effect, but if you don't have it, you can do that with local anesthetic. So the landmark for the PENG block is the iliopubic eminence. It's that, if you remember the movie I showed, it was the tip showing like this. So you when you are putting the probe, this caudal cephalate, you see the head of the femur and something looking like this, which is the iliopubic eminence. And if you are seeing this tip of the triangle, you put your local anesthetic here, and here on site on the other of the iliopubic eminence, and there is the proper place to perform a pain block. For the lumbar plexus block, it is simple by put local anesthetic after fascial puncture or injected intramuscular. No, I would not recommend intramuscular injection. So I think the trick in avoiding side effects, the trick in making the best out of your lumbar plexus block is to understand that the tip of the needle should stop between two transversus process in the fascial layer. So I would not recommend doing by intention intramuscular injections. Will ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric will be enough for hernia, especially when contained bowel death? No, definitely not. So ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric is not enough to do a hernia repair, but it's not reducing the visceral pain. You need to have an educated surgeon and this understanding what you are doing, because you will only be performing anesthesia with ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric nerve blocks to the patients that they are so sick that you will be worried that performing one side spinal anesthesia will kill them. So I'm talking about patients with severe comorbidities that usually they come to emergency room telling you that 20 years ago, they told me I need to have surgery for my hernia repair, but they said they I'm too sick for anesthesia. So they lived another 15, 20 years, and they are coming to the emergency department, and you need to give them a chance to live. So you will do them ilioinguinal, iliohypogastric nerve block. The surgeon is starting the surgery, and while he's in the inguinal canal, you need to remember that you also have the genitofemoral nerve that you cannot reach to it because the hernia is covering your axis there. And the surgeon needs to do that. And when they reach the peritoneum and they start dissecting the hernial sac, the surgeon needs also to put local anesthetic solution there. And this is the way how you assure that that patient will live. Otherwise, they are patient that they may be killed because of the anesthesia. Would you use neurolytic for ultrasound-guided lumbar plexus block? Definitely not. So I don't know if you are still alive, Hatem, please complete your questions and tell me what is the pathology you are thinking about. Because if you will do neurolytic on the lumbar plexus block, you will have motor block forever. So you don't want to do that. So depending on the chronic pain condition you are thinking about, you may consider different things. If it's a painful procedure, a painful condition in the lower leg, then you may think to the lumbar sympathetic definitive block, like using neurolytics, but it's better if you are doing radiofrequency ablation. And if it's something that it's involving a nerve that has also a motor component, you might want to do pulse radiofrequency treatment for the spinal nerve. So in this way, you will have analgesia, but no, oh, for the pain, okay. Yes, for pain, that, you know, no, I will not do neurolytics. For the pain block, no, I will do radiofrequency ablation. You know why? I know, and I talk with people doing neurolytics block in that region, but I would be afraid of the spread of the neurolytic solution. If you are using alcohol solution is something that is spreading very, very fast. If you are putting that in a fascia, you may hope it's contained there. But if you are putting that in a place like where you are performing the pain block and there is more so much, I would be worried. So I will not use neurolytic block. I think it's better to do radiofrequency treatment. Do you use any sedation during surgery under nerve blocks? If it's possible, yes. But if the patient is a very, very sick COPD patient with CPAP at night at home, then I would consider that no, sedation is not an option. What I noticed to this kind of patient, they are so motivated because the patient population I'm talking about, when they have their hernia incarcerated, it's something they are waiting for years because the surgeon 15, 10, 20 years ago told them, you are too sick for you to survive surgery. And when you will come in emergency, you will die. Usually they say, I didn't want to come to the hospital because they told me I will die if you will become incarcerated. But I come to the hospital because the pain is too heavy to bear. And usually I tell them that I have a solution for you that will take the pain away, but it also allow the surgeon to do surgery on you. Will you accept that? And I do the blocks and then they accept the surgery. So they are so motivated that you don't need sedation to them. I think I answered all the questions that I have in my panel.
So I think there is no more questions right now. If anyone has any other questions, maybe later you can follow our Wisonic LinkedIn and Facebook public account. And we also upload this webinar video on Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn to share to more audience and anesthesiologists globally. And thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Derzu, for your sharing about your research about regional anesthesia. And later.
Thank you so much for that invitation.
Okay. And thank you, everyone, audience. I mean, thank you for coming. And thanks for your questions and your communications with Dr. Derzu. Okay. Let's look forward to the next webinar with Dr. Derzu. And good night, everyone.
Thank you so much, Olga, for inviting me. And thank you all for being here. Oh, now I found, meanwhile, the list of attendance. So thank you so much for being here. I was not alone, after all.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Derzu.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.